I do not see discrimination.
Okay.
There is that aura around everybody, you know. If you are from a state or a country or somewhere where you have this kind of virus going on, you know, there is always that kind of stigma.
Mm.
And young minds may not be able to handle the trauma that people try to avoid you, you know, in a situation where there is also the social. So it's better for us not to kill their minds. You know, it's a psychological thing in which we must, as a responsible nation, you know, not subject it at least to. That's the reason.
But before I allow you to go, I don't want to be very clear about it. Have there been cases where our athletes have been treated differently? The 14 athletes, 5 officials have been treated differently from the other participants at the Youth Olympics in China?
It is natural that every country will have to protect, you know, itself from this kind of virus. Of course, those countries that have signs or have been labeled or tagged for having this Ebola virus have gone through series of tests that are different from the other ones that do not have this treatment. As far as we are concerned, none of these athletes have it, they do not have it, and they are not having it. But we still see that even if you are working on the street, but even an old man in that place, you will not be free. People will not be free with you like the naturally like to be. You just come back from the Commonwealth Games. You are free to walk around the village. You are free to go to the barrio. You are free to walk around and be friends. But in this situation now, you may come to a situation whereby you will naturally, you don't know that you are not having a free mind. You can't operate. And Nigeria is a free country. We love our good ones. We do not want to traumatize them. So I think we should come back home. Mm. And that is just taken. So we are coming back home. Definitely.
They will be in tomorrow, you said? In 48 hours.
I'm not too sure whether the flight arrangements can continue to go out tomorrow, but within the next 48 hours, I expect them to go back home.
Mm. All right, so that's the story around Team Nigeria. But before I allow you to go to Nipopola, what are the implications of Nigeria pulling out at the last minute? The Youth Olympics is not... what are the implications for us withdrawing from the Youth Olympics?
Let me put it very straightforward so that people will understand it again. The World Health Organization, the IOC, the government of China, they are quite aware of all the surrounding situation. You know, so instead of saying the world is having a pullout, you know, it's something that we cannot really say yes. We are pulling out for any particular reason. The reasons are cogent enough, and they are aware as well. They know themselves. So in fact, I think the basic reasons are very, very, very clear. So we are told that we are not expecting any kind of punishment. However, you know, that we will go and then we'll come back home, you know,
Well, thank you so much for speaking to us, Tunde Popola, Secretary General, Nigeria Olympic Committee, giving us that bit of breaking news for us to talk about. Nigeria is pulling out of the 2014 Youth Olympics in China. And Tunde Popola has explained to you the reason why Team Nigeria is pulling out. 14 athletes, 5 officials are already there for the games. But they are pulling out, Nigeria is pulling out, and in 48 hours, these athletes should be back in Nigeria. Of course, we'll get more details subsequently when we have more information around it, and of course, we will let you know. But that's the breaking news that we're starting off Sports Tonight with this very explosive Wednesday night. Team Nigeria no longer part of the Youth Olympics. And when you look at how much we've invested, gentlemen, into the Youth Olympics, we've had the youth festival here. We've had a lot of competitions to prepare them for this one, but at the last minute, we just have to pull out in the interest of our athletes and maybe in the interest of the nation.
Well, it's nobody's fault, really. I mean, we have found ourselves in a dilemma.
Mm.
And you don't blame anybody who wants to make sure that their citizens are protected from this virus. You know, if we put ourselves in this situation, we probably do the same thing. You know, you cannot allow, because you want to participate in sports, you jeopardize the lives of other people. So I think whichever way you look at it, the right decision was taken. For these young people to come back, you know, let us see how we're able to contain this virus. Perhaps thereafter, There are so many championships they can take part in. Mm. You know, let them come back, continue. The sports ministry can, you know, map out some programs for them to keep busy, not get so traumatized, not psychologically down.
Because when you are already there at the center of a competition, at the venue, and you have to pull out for non-sporting reasons, but for crucial reasons like what we have, Tunde Bukola explained to us as well. Well, that's the situation we found ourselves, and I think that's what we have to live with at the moment. Still talking about the Ebola crisis and the dimensions it is taking across the globe. Let's come back to Africa, because it is really also beginning to have a major stake on what is going on around African football. Yesterday we were talking about Togo asking that their game against Guinea be moved to a neutral venue, but CAF has not just moved it to a neutral venue, they've postponed the game by a month. So Togo now have their wish.
Well, it's not just only Togo. Teams involving Sierra Leone, they have to do that because of the... We just mentioned the Youth Olympic in the engine China, what athletes went through because they wanted to be quarantined. So it's a global emergency, and a lot of countries have become a bit scared. And sport is one of those... Football is a contact sport. So once you have one or two contact with somebody perceived to have this virus, there's every likelihood that you're going to cut across. It's very contagious, and it can easily transfer from one person to another based on the kind of contact you had with that person. So even Rwanda have written to CAF requesting that our game be moving from Calabar. I don't know how that will work out, but CAF is not really officially. There's no official statement from CAF that letter has gotten to them. So it's going back and forth. A lot of countries are becoming a bit scared. They don't want this thing to get creeped into their country. Ours, like Tunde just mentioned, but it was a statement made by credited to the president. That's one man from Liberia brought it to Nigeria and became a big issue for Nigeria. We are battling with it in spite of all our numerous problems, and that's what we're facing. So it's something that... for football, there should be some limit at which you get this thing get to some other country, so that football will not be an avenue where people have been lost. Lost because it has been an opportunity for people to enjoy themselves.
Football should not be a tool to spread
virus
all around. But the Lesotho under 20 team that are supposed to come for our game against the Flying Eagles in Kaduna this weekend, are they in town already, or are they still saying they won't come because of the fear of the virus?
No, they just lodged a complaint with CAF, but
asking that look, like, Nigeria.
But they don't have any option because CAF has remained silent.
Have not made any pronouncement.
You know, because of the emergency situation in Sierra Leone and Guinea, they had to move, you know, Sierra Leone to Ghana. Then Guinea are yet to get a venue for their own game.
And their game moved by a month as well.
By a month. So the players from Lesotho have no reason not to be in the country because whether you like it or not, ours is still an isolated case in Nigeria. Only two deaths, including the doctor and the man from Liberia, Patrick Sawyer. You know, so it's still an isolated case. They can still come to Kaduna and play their game and leave. They are not coming here to be on leisure. They just play their game. Our players are not our players are not carrying the virus.
Yes.
Play your game, and you can immediately go back to your country and enjoy yourself. So that should not be a big problem for them.
All right, so that's the story around it. The virus is spreading and is really threatening the game on the African continent. Well, let's move on very quickly to some other issues that are also crucially important for us tonight. Yesterday was drama around the Nigerian Football Federation and banning people. Today is a different story altogether. In fact, today, the crisis around Nigerian football wasn't so much about is Aminu Megiri coming back, is he not coming back, is about who becomes the next president of the Nigerian Football Federation and who are those that will become the next executive committee members. We're talking about the NFF elections. And as you can see on your screen, the electoral committee at last has surfaced at their secretariat in Abuja. And once they surfaced, they made a pronouncement that has set the entire football family upside down. What are we talking about? Sit back, listen to the chairman of that committee make a pronouncement, and we will be taking you to Abuja to get more details around it, because our friends standing by will be shedding more light on all that has happened today in Abuja around the elections into the Executive Committee of the Nigerian Football Federation.
Good morning. Chief Mike Umeh, Southeast, Anambra, has applied to contest for the post of President, not cleared. Chief Taiwo Ogunjobi, Southwest, Osun State, he applied for the post of President, is not cleared. Now, why is it not cleared? The applicant, Chief Taiwo Ogunjobi, is serving a 10-year